So I think there's another class, one more class that of problems that we didn't really get a chance to get. There are tons, by the way, just to be clear, algorithms and representation that we didn't really get into. A lot of them actually coming out of big data, like KD-trees, for example. But there's a whole class of problems we didn't really discuss that's actually quite important. And that's because it reveals one of the assumptions that we've had. And so I'm going to call them sort of the assumption of balanced labels.
Balanced labels.
Yeah, which is related to cost-sensitive learning and a variety of other things. So implicit in a lot of the work that we talked about was this idea that, you know, if you're a big data set, about half of them are labeled negative and about half of them are labeled positive.
Sure.
Right? But in practice, the world doesn't work that way, and you have to actually take that into account.
So what would be an example?
So here's my favorite example. So imagine you have a camera. So close your eyes. Yeah, imagine you have a camera, and let's say that it's in an airport, like we are now. And people are going through constantly. In fact, you're in Atlanta Airport, which is the world's busiest airport. And there are cameras constantly taking pictures of you, and there are. And we're trying to find terrorists. So we're taking pictures of people and of their faces, say, and maybe what they're wearing. And we just want to label which ones are terrorists and which ones aren't. Well, the vast majority of people are not terrorists, we hope, even the ones going through airports. And so let's say 99% of the people that come through, you would label negative. And less than 1% you would label positive. Does that make sense as a problem?
Yeah, though I'm thinking about this issue about most people aren't terrorists. Like, I feel like, are there really any non-terrorists? Or are we all just terrorists who just haven't gotten inspired yet?
You've met my son. So let's say terrorists, by some definition, that we're willing to accept.
Yeah, yeah, sort of. Well, let's not.
How about a threat? A threat.
That's where I was going to go. Yes, forget whether they're terrorists or not. Just in the airport cares. This person is threatening to the safety of the airport.
And in fact, we can back it up a little bit and say it's not even terrorists. It's just someone that's going to cause some kind of trouble, as defined by the airport. So, you know, we'll get irritated when they go through the line. Okay?
That explains why the last time that we got together in Atlanta, I was chased by police.
You were chased by police. That's a funny story. He was literally chased by the police at the Atlanta airport. You got out of that one pretty well, I thought.
Thanks.
Eventually.
Yeah.
They were not happy with that.
Anyway, so
let's say maybe 3% of people cause trouble in a day, Michael.
Yeah.
And let's say the other 97% don't. So if you were going to throw this at a learner, what would happen? The best learner is probably the one that just says...
No one will cause trouble.
No one will cause trouble.
Right, because it could be wrong sometimes. Yeah, that's right. It'll be wrong sometimes, but very rarely.
Yeah, 97% is pretty good. Well, that's... the problem that's called the majority classifier.
Yes,
and it's a baseline, which we've talked about a little bit.
Sure.
And the problem is that when your algorithm does 97%, that's actually not very impressive. On the one hand, but there's this other issue, which is that
on this data, it's not so impressive.
On this data, it's not so impressive. But there's this other issue, which is the cost of being wrong when someone really is going to cause trouble is much higher. So it's actually very important that you get that 3%. You can't just treat it as 3%.
I see.
So I'm going to just very briefly go through this, and then we're going to move on. There's a bunch of approaches to this. You could reweight the way you do error. There's all kinds of clever things you can do. But there's one that I really like, which is due to Paul Viola and Mike Jones. It was applied to a vision problem. It's called cascade learning. I like this because it's a seminal paper. I like this because it's really good work. And also because Paul Viola was one of my advisors and Mike Jones was my office mate when I was in grad school. And they did all of this while I was sitting there and didn't put me on their paper. So,
You think you should be on the paper just by virtue of the fact that you were there inspiring them with your presence?
My agent notes would go up by one.
Yeah.
And that's important.